Now, friends, let me go ahead and straight away start with the revision with respect to the international taxation. Friends, as I already told you that this is our exam day revision. That means I'm not going to take your much of the hours. As I already told you that I will take around 3 hours approximately, max to max. And during these particular videos, I will tell you that you can just pause somewhere and refer this particular thing very precisely. Tentatively, friends, maximum you give me about 5 to 6 hours for your exam day revision. That from my side should be more than sufficient. The balance 10 hours or so, which you already have it for your exam day preparation, please, you have to do it by yourself, and your own revision is the best revision, friends, let me tell you. And of course, I should never forget to wish you all the best. So all the best for your examination, friends. And remember that don't ever get scared in the examination condition. Suppose some questions, if you don't know, never get scared. I mean, just first of all, do whatever that you know. Try to do that particular thing's best. And nothing can stop you, let me tell you, that once you have done the proper revision, proper understanding, and believe me, once you have done the course, as far as what I have already guided you, nothing is going to stop you. Let me straight away go to the international taxation. The first ever concept that you, if you want, you can just pause this particular video here and you can revise what is P2P and P2A relationship. See, international taxation basically begins with the fundamental grassroots concept of principal to agent relationship. So where a foreign person appoints someone or someone in India, the domestic India, works under the instruction of that particular principal, he is regarded as a principal to agent. And when there is a principal to agent relationship, that means a foreign person and an Indian person acts as an agent. In that particular case, the domestic income is of course taxable. There is no doubt about that. But even the foreign income of that particular person is subject matter of taxation in India. And together with that, friends, there is a concept of business connection. With the business connection, friends, there is a concept of agent. With that, there is a concept of dependent agent. So these are hardcore few theory points covered by section 9. The dependent agent, business connection, the types of incomes which are deemed to accrue or rise in India. Please, if you want, please pause your video a little bit for some time here and turn our classwork questions, refer the material that I've already explained to you, and go through this particular concept that in what all situations this business connection concept come into picture. The conclusion is, if there is a business connection, then the income of the foreign person become taxable in India, just like as if it is your deemed to accrue or arise in India. And that creates a tax liability, and the Indian person, the so-called agent, will be responsible for the purpose of taxation. Now, friends, some students always get confused that, sir, see, there is already a TDS provision, there is already a tax payment provisions, then why is there another concept of agent, dependent agent, business connection, and all that kind of things? Let me tell you, friends, they are all alternative remedies. In other words, see, that the when it comes to the tax recovery of the government, don't imagine that everybody is going to be very honest and pay directly to the government. So government under the law has to have alternative mechanism. Supposing if TDS fails, that means, for example, somebody has done default in the TDS, then there should be some other alternative mechanism. So all the mechanism like TDS mechanism, payment of tax mechanism, tax recovery, agent, business connection, all these concepts and all these responsibilities, they work together. That means they're all alternate. So don't assume that if one method is available or if one style of recovery is possible, other style is not possible. Don't think like that. It depends on the situation to situation. They're all options open to the law, and law will try to recover as much as possible. Friends, one of the most important thing in section 9, again, if you want to pause the video here and see the definition of the royalty technical fees. I repeat, pause the video here and see the definition of the royalty technical fees, which is defined under section 9. Section 9, which is deemed to accrue or arise in India, their royalty technical fees, interest and business connection. These are the most popular transactions. There is also some transactions with respect to salary and this and that. But I once again repeat, royalty technical fees, interest and business connection related transactions are the most important transactions with respect to the business connection. Now, friends, royalty technical fees definition is in depth. I once again advise you, pause your video here and go through the definition of the royalty technical fees. Now, friends, on the definition of the royalty technical fees, there had been in past examinations many, many variety of questions. I would rather say that it is a repeated question, but the question language keeps changing. I mean, I'm not trying to say it will always be a verbatim repeated question, that is never going to happen. But on that particular concept of royalty technical fees, there had been repeated focus in the examination, and it is bound to happen. content, because that is one of the biggest and the most valuable area of the international taxation. There is major chunk of movement of money. I repeat, major chunk of movement of money in international taxation either happens on the account of royalty technical fees or on the account of interest. So interest, royalty technical fees, these three are the most valuable transactions from the international taxation point of view, where the huge money is already involved. Now just look at this particular few variety type questions, where ultimately friends, students will just have to assess whether it is a royalty technical fees. Since it is an exam day revision, I'll just keep it very short and sweet. Now if you see, this is one of the very very valuable question of the Bharat Mines Limited, and all these questions we already solved in the regular class. If you want, you can just refer it also from our regular class. Now this particular question of Bharat Mines, in this particular question friends, some data has been given that there is some Indian concern paying some fees, some charges to that particular foreign concern. But if you see here, nowhere the word royalty technical fees is mentioned in the question. It says that, see, the payment is made on account of drawings, designs, engineering services, salary and other allowances to the staff deputed in India for the work in India or something like that, it is provided. If you read every question, every variety of the question, nowhere it will clearly print that it is payment on account of royalty technical fees. In other words, what is a royalty? What is a technical fees? Is by itself defined, and it's a very long definition. And friends, let me tell you, internationally every country has this kind of definition, and every definition is a lengthy and a detailed kind of a definition. Now if you see this payment, because for the use of these drawings, designs, etc., they are basically a kind of a royalty technical fees. So the meaning of royalty technical fees, based on that, some 3-mark question, 4-mark question. So ultimately this kind of question, friends, you have to identify that this particular payment is on account of royalty technical fees, and accordingly it will be deemed to accrue or arise in India, concept of deemed to accrue or arise in India. And if the question asks you that to calculate tax liability, there is also extra little bit of a work that you have to do on account of calculation of the tax liability. Keep that in mind. I once again repeat that meaning of royalty technical, the definition of the royalty technical fees must be studied very properly by you just the day before the examination. Now friends, there is something called the special rates of taxes. The special rates of taxes, friends, time and again I have discussed even in the regular class, but let me tell you that these special rates of taxes, which is in relation to the special income, is to be multiplied with the special rates of taxes. Generally, friends, this is generally, okay? Generally, basic exemption, you don't get it. Generally, expenditure as a deduction against this particular income, you don't get it. Chapter 6, a deduction against the specified income, you don't get it. And Provision 1, Provision 2 to Section 48, that is extended fluctuation and the indexation benefit. This is with respect to the capital gains transactions, if any, generally you don't get it. So, the theme of Chapter 12, the special rates of taxes, this particular chapter and wherever some other sections of the special rates of taxes generally have this particular modus operandi. However, somewhere there is on-off kind of provision. That means somewhere in some of the sections it may say that yes, it may be allowed. However, generally it is not allowed. That means in majority of the section it will not be allowed. So this on-off situation, you got to be a little bit cautious and you got to be very, very careful. In this particular situation, two of the most important on-off situation where section 112A and section 111A. This particular section, if assessee is a resident, if it is a short-term capital gains on the listed shares, long-term capital gains, or long-term capital gains on the listed shares, if assessee is a resident, so these three sections are the unique piece of on-off situation with respect to the basic exemption limit. If the assessee is a resident, then the basic exemption limit with respect to the specified income is available. But if the assessee is a non-resident in the same to same sections, then the basic exemption, as per the general understanding only, it is not applicable, and therefore you cannot use the basic exemption limit. How the tax liability can be different in this particular situation? Let me give you one hardcore basic example. That supposing if I say that I have only one long-term capital gains, this long-term capital gains is covered by section 112. Okay, so section 112 takes care of long-term capital gains. This long-term capital gains I have, I am an individual, so I get a basic exemption limit. But let us assume that I don't have any other income and I just have 10,000 rupees of long-term capital gains. So normally I would feel that 10,000 rupees is less than basic exemption limit, so I will not have any tax liability to pay. So the resident person tax liability will be nil, because I will be using basic exemption limit for the long-term capital gains. I don't have any other income. But same thing if assessee would have been a known resident, he will have to pay the tax liability on this long-term capital gains. Of course, the applicable surcharge has to be considered, but this is a basic example so that I have already ignored it. So this is an on-off situation. These three sections, remember friends, very very carefully, that you do not get the basic exemption limit generally, but to the resident assessee you get it. So that's one of the on-off situation. Normally basic exemption question is no. Similarly, for chapter 6A deduction, friends, royalty technical fees, which is covered by section 115A, for that, normally the chapter 6A deduction is not available, but there, for the royalty technical fees, against the royalty technical fees, chapter 6A deduction is permissible, some technical interpretation. So, normally, friends, it is chapter 6 also deduction is denied against the specified income, but for the royalty technical fees, there is an exception. However, there are some more exceptions, there are some one-off provisions also, which I already discussed in the regular class, but these are some of the most popular ones, so I bring it to your notice in my just the exam day revision. Friends, this is your tax liability calculation, a simple tax liability calculation, okay? So, generally, you don't get basic exemption limit. This is what I just want to bring it to your notice. So, if it is your royalty technical fees income, this is your income, multiply with the special rates of tax and get the tax liability figures. So, it is just like a flat rate of something like a flat. I should not say flat rate of tax, but it is something like a flat rate of tax. Specified income, specified rate, multiply. This is how the tax liability will get calculated. Some other specified income, example, debenture interest, of course, it should have been covered by section 115A. So, assume that it is covered by A, multiply with the special rates of tax and get the tax liability. Consider with the applicable surcharge and the applicable sales, and you will get the amount of the tax liability. So, this is the method in which special rates of taxes do get implemented in this particular situation. This was a simple way of calculation. Okay, now let me give you an example of a tax liability of a non-resident. Here also, see, it's a simple tax liability of non-resident, but somewhere, friends, there is a difference between tax liability of resident and non-resident. See, sometime back, that basic exemption which I already explained to you, like, for example, if I just go back here, if you see this particular situation which I already explained, here, see, the non-resident, okay, and resident. So, there is a difference. Resident can get the basic exemption against specified income and non-resident cannot get it. Similarly, friends, there is a variety of on-off situation with respect to resident and non-resident. Now, for example, senior citizen. A senior citizen, suppose a resident senior citizen gets a higher basic exemption limit. Non-resident senior citizen don't get it. For example, ATD Mediclaim. In respect to the Mediclaim, the resident senior citizen gets a higher Mediclaim limit, resident senior citizen. However, if it is a non-resident senior citizen, they do get ATD benefit, but they don't get the higher limit. The higher limit of ATD for senior citizen is only for the resident senior citizen. So, similarly, friends, there is an on-off kind of situation. So, one simple example, friends, I just bring it to your notice, that is your tax liability calculation. Okay. Now, if you observe in this particular case, simply see, he is a non-resident here. Okay, now non-resident has got some special rates income, some general income in this particular example. So, this is your other incomes, this is your special rate income. Now, your other income you will multiply with your individual rates of tax, because the assess is an individual in this particular situation. Now, he's a non-resident but senior citizen. Now, non-resident senior citizen in the slab system, see, I have not given a higher basic exemption limit. However, the same example, same number, but he is a resident person and he's a senior citizen. So, he is a resident and the senior citizen will be eligible for the purpose of higher basic exemption limit, and that is how same example, same numbers, but your basic exemption limit has changed. So, if you are a resident senior citizen, you have to give the higher basic exemption limit, then again follow the slab 1, slab 2, etc. type of working of a tax liability calculation, and when you do this, you get the appropriate amount of the tax liability. But what is the difference between these two examples? These two examples is, one place is a non-resident senior citizen, other place is a resident senior citizen. So, non-resident senior citizen is not available for higher basic exemption limit. Similar example, I have already got it, another example, where we have taken an example where somebody is a resident senior citizen and non-resident senior citizen. So, resident, okay, yes, one place it is yes, other place no. That means one place you are non-resident, other place you are a resident person. That kind of a situation, okay. Now, in this case, you see the ATD deduction or the calculation, both of them are senior citizen only. I repeat, both of them are senior citizen only. But in one case, amounts are the same. The question is the same. The example is the same. Where a person is a non-resident senior citizen, we have given ATD deduction. It's not that ATD is not available. ATD is available, but the higher limit of ATD for senior citizen will not be applicable. But if you are a resident senior citizen, you can get a higher limit of section 80D. That is the basically the difference in terms of computation, where assess is resident or the assess is non-resident individual. See the basic exemption. The basic exemption limit also. If you are a resident senior citizen, you are given a higher basic exemption limit, and you are a non-resident senior citizen, you are not given a. That means basic exemption limit is available, but you do not get the higher basic exemption limit. That is the difference between the resident senior citizen and the non-resident senior citizen. These were friends in many sections. I mean, let me tell you that this is not just one ATD as an example, but there are many section friends where the law refers to only resident, or some of the deductions are only for resident, or some of the benefits are only for resident, not for non-resident vis-a-vis. I call it as a on-off provisions. Okay, this on-off provision, friends, it is there in the variety of the law. I mean, don't believe that sir has taught you just one or two. They are only illustrative things. However, friends, we as a student, it's not our open book examination, so we are not in the position to open the law and see each time. So it is something like a mugging up situation. But one thing, let me tell you, I have given you a list in our study material where the popular examination types on off. I repeat, ladies and gentlemen, popular examination type on off kind of situation. One small little summary that I have already prepared for you, and that you can refer it in this our revision class also. I think that somewhere some page is there that is going to come, that I will show to you maybe after some time when this particular sequence where it already comes. Okay, so remember this on off situation with respect to the non-resident assessee or the non-resident situation. Okay, as simple as that. Now friends, let me take up this particular chapter 12, special rates of taxes. Now friends, let me go ahead and with the discussion of this special rates of taxes chapter 12. First of all friends, from the special rates of taxes, there are two important chapters which we need to study and which we need to analyze. One is called as chapter 12, other is called as chapter 12A. Chapter 12 and chapter 12A, one of the major differences that chapter 12A is applicable only for non-resident Indians. I repeat, chapter 12A is applicable only for the non-resident Indians. However, chapter 12, it is a general purpose mixed chapter where non-residents are also covered and some of the transaction the residents are also covered. This chapter 12 is purely about special rates of taxes, and the special rates of taxes, friends, the general feature of all the sections in this particular chapter is like no basic exemption you get it. You don't get any expenditure as the deduction against the specified income. You do not get chapter 6A deduction against the specified income, and provision 1 and provision 2 to section 48 generally is not available if there was a capital gains transaction. This is a general feature. However, in certain situation there is an on-off situation, so somewhere it is yes no kind of situation that is already there, and time and again I have brought to your notice in this particular chapter. Now here the tax liability, the purpose of this particular chapter is purely the determination of the tax liability, and that particular tax liability working is always something very important. Examination condition almost every first, second, one to attempt a question based on special rates of taxes has to come, because that is a very very important part of the discussion. Let me take up the first ever simple example of non-resident and non-citizen sports person, okay, or a performer. First thing friends, this section 115 BBS special rates of tax for non-resident, non-citizen sports person or a performer is a very very important type transaction. Oftenly friends, it has got repeated in the examination condition. There is a special rates of taxes. Before I just go ahead friends, let me tell you that in the recent past the law has been amended to include even the performers, even the performers. So the answer will of course be the same, but for example, somebody who is doing a stand-up comedy, somebody who is a dance artist, or somebody who is a musician, somebody who is a singer who basically perform and entertain the people, even those kind of persons will be covered by this particular section. On this particular area, question has not come. Like for example, many times question has come saying that there was a non-resident, non-citizen sports person, some Brian Lara of some South Indian cricket team, that person has come to India, played some matches. That kind of example has already come in the examination condition many times. But this performer, has answer will remain the same only, but the performers will also be covered by section 115 BBA. Like for example, dancer, musician, persons who is doing stand-up comedy, there can be some circus artist, that is also a possibility. Say for example, there was a Russian circus and those Russian artists have come to India, they have done the performance and they've entertained the people basically, and then they have gone back. So basic condition, non-resident, non-citizen. Then you multiply the special rates of tax. So this is a special rates of tax, your special income. Anyway, you already know generally the basic exemption is not available. So although the assess is individual, we have not to consider any basic exemptions, slab 1, slab 2, etc. for the specified incomes. Had it been the other incomes, we could have considered that. But in this particular example, it is not there. Then that particular person had some horse races income. So for horse races income, 115 BB is a specified income. Multiply with the special rates of tax, get the tax liability, consider the applicable surcharge in the assess, and the tax liability is over. So it's a simple working friends. Only thing that you should know that this is a special rate and this is the type of the income which is called by the special rates. Thereafter, the working has become quite simple. Once you already know that, add the applicable surcharge in the cess and get the amount of the tax liability. Straight away 3-4 marks, whatever is in the examination condition, can be in your pocket. Now in 115 BBA provision, this is one of the unique piece of the provision 115 BBA, where there is a relaxation given. Under that particular particular section with respect to the return of income. That means, for example, if the assessee would have got only 115 BBA income and would have got no other income, and the tax required to be deducted have already been deducted. Once this much compliance was done, that means ultimately government has already recovered the taxes on account of this particular transaction. In that case, government says you need not file return of income. That means there is a relaxation, procedural advantage is also there by not requiring that gentleman to file the return of India and do the Indian procedures in this particular situation. But if you see in this particular question, our example, this non-resident, non-citizen sports person or a performer has 115 BBA income plus he has got 115 BBA income. Okay, so in this particular situation, we cannot say that you have not to file the return of income. So advantage of not filing return of income is not available. So we should say that yes, he should file the return of income. The reason being that he has 115 BBA income plus he has got some other activities, some other incomes also, and therefore the procedural advantage will not be available to that particular gentleman, should be kept in mind. Now friends, there is another good variety of question which has recently come up from the past examination, and that is the same type of a transaction. They will ask you TDS implications. So they will ask you that, friends, how much tax is to be deducted and under what particular provisions the tax is to be deducted. Now, one thing from the TDS point of view, friends, let me tell you, every payment to non-resident, this is kind of a thumb rule. It's like a golden rule that every payment to the non-resident, once if you decide that it is taxable in India, that means it is a taxable transaction and it creates a tax liability in India. If that is the transaction, tax has to be deducted. Keep that in mind. That is number one. So never think that, oh, there is a transaction taxable, but tax is not required to be deducted. Such situation you will never ever find. Okay. So taxable transaction, TDS for non-resident is always yes, yes, and yes. Always. Okay. Second thing is, friends, wherever there is a non-resident TDS, plus the applicable surcharge and plus the applicable cess. Keep this in mind. This is for the non-resident, I'm telling you. Had it been a resident TDS, then it is all round figure TDS. That means there you don't have to extra top it up with the applicable surcharge and the cess. But a non-resident transaction has to be considered with the applicable amount of the surcharge and the cess in that particular situation. So TDS questions, if that come, TDS has to be deducted. And second thumb rule I'm just telling you, or second tip just I'm just trying to tell you. See, generally wherever there is a special rates of taxes applicable, remember one thing very carefully. This is a general thing. Somewhere ifs and buts are possible, but this can work well in the examination condition. If any situation, non-resident, and if there is a special rates of tax applicable, supposing you already remember that, okay, under this particular section, there is special rates of tax. So TDS also will be the same rate of tax. Generally, friends, I'm telling you, the rates of tax and the rate of TDS will match. Okay. So government don't want to have over deduction. Government don't even want to have a short deduction. Keep that in mind. So what government basically wants, that exactly what is a tax liability, same figure should have been deducted. That is the whole objective of the law. So generally, friends, because see, it's a TDS, there is a long list of transactions and students may not be able to mug it up that particular situation. So it's a general tip I'm telling you. The rate of tax will be the same as the rate of TDS by and large. Okay. So if you get confused and if you just want that shortcut answer in the examination condition, this is how it can work. Okay. Now the tax is to be deducted. Supposing if the question asks you that there is a transaction of a non-resident and you have to deduct the tax. So simple. Supposing if you are making gross payment of X amount, say for example, in this example, it is 5 lakhs. Consider the rate of TDS. Consider the applicable surcharge and the cess. Surcharge will apply only if the transaction limit would have exceeded the limit of the surcharge, otherwise surcharge not apply. Consider the applicable amount of the cess, total TDS and the net payment. Okay. So give your breakup. Give your breakup even from the TDS point of view, that this is your gross payment minus TDS, and TDS has to be topped up with the element of the surcharge and the cess. Give always the breakup, total TDS and the net payment. So this is how, and this much if you do, some 2 or 3 mark situation will come in your pocket. Now friends, in the examination condition, there is a new trick of asking you that particular question. The question has told you that the gross payment is, say for example, 5 lakhs. Okay. Some of the questions will tell you that the net payment by itself is 5 lakhs. Okay. So that means you are paying to that particular non-resident, supposing the sports person, as a net payment. Okay. Net of tax. So from the TDS point of view, friends, you have to just gross it up. So you just have to do the reverse calculation. No big deal. But that mathematical thing should always be known to you. So supposing if here the net payment was some 3 lakhs and some odd number which was coming, but supposing if you assume that your net payment by itself is rupees 5 lakhs, And that is what could have been printed in the question. Then what would have been the amount of the TDS? And logically, what would be the gross amount of the income in that particular situation? You just have to do the reverse calculation and get the amount of the TDS. And again, do the reverse calculation and get the amount of the gross amount of. So remember that this is one new trick which has come in the examination condition. Often to test your knowledge by telling you that what if this particular payment made to the non-resident is a net of tax payment. So the tax has to be deducted, but then you have to gross it up and you have to work it other way around mathematically.
Now friends, this was one of the situation where there was a foreign company, and this particular foreign company in the given question is not given to us whether it is a resident or a non-resident. So we go with the view that this was a foreign company and a non-resident, and this particular company had a permanent establishment, then had a branch office in India, therefore it had a permanent establishment in India. Now moment friends, you know this much of fact, it is a foreign company. Okay, and it has a branch in India. First of all, foreign company means you have to, unless it is given that it was resident in India, it is better that we follow the view that it was non-resident. And the moment you say that there was a branch in India, it means that section 115A provisions will not apply, because this will be a situation covered by section 44DA. Okay, in other words, if you have a permanent establishment in India, then the special rate of tax of section 115A do not apply in this particular situation. Okay, now friends, in the given case, this particular company had rate, so the normal foreign company's tax rate, that is 40%, that particular tax rate will be applicable to its normal income. Okay, now this particular company had some technical fees etc. provisions, but because you are covered by 44DA provision, the normal rate of tax will apply, the special rate of tax of 115A provision will not apply. Why? Because this particular company had a branch in India. That was one of the basis of this kind of a computation. Okay, and therefore this income, although it is a technical fees, you may feel that it is covered by section 115A, but that particular special rate of tax will not be applicable in this particular situation. So I have already taken multiply with the 40%. Okay, now 115 BBDA provision, here sometimes some people debate on this particular front, but 115 BBDA provision applies to a specified assessee who is a resident in India. And once you are a non-resident in India, a company is a non-resident in India, then 115 BBDA provision do not apply. That means whatever is the amount of the dividend. So even if the dividend is 12 lakhs of rupees, which is more than 10 lakhs of rupees, that is the limit of 115 BBDA provision, still it will not be taxable. It will not be taxable under 115 BBDA provision. Okay. Reason being that this given assessee is a non-resident person, and because the 115 BBDA provision is applicable only to the specified resident assessee. Okay, now the next thing is that this particular company had some interest income, which was a specified interest income covered by section 115A special rate of tax. So to that extent, I can multiply special rate of tax. 115 BBF, the royalty from patent. Now royalty from patent, basically friends, it's applicable only in relation to the resident assessee. Okay, but this particular answer that we are giving, this particular fact that we are discussing, is keeping in mind that the assessee is a non-resident, and that's the reason 115 BBF provision also we will not apply, and that's the reason for this kind of royalty from patent. We are going to multiply with a normal rate of tax, and that is 40%. Okay, because that is with respect to this particular foreign company. Now on that, we will multiply the applicable amount of the surcharge and applicable amount of the cess and get the amount of the tax liability. Now friends, here sometimes some people take a different view with respect to the 115 BBDA applicability, because it is a specified assessee resident in India, and specified assessee has already been defined here. The specified assessee does not include domestic companies, some of the charitable institutions and the charitable trust. So these people are again not covered by section 115 BBDA provision. So for example, if the trust has got some very huge amount of the dividend income, then also 115 BBDA provisions will not be applicable. So the people sometimes get confused and saying that the specified assessee, that means a domestic company, is not a specified assessee. So foreign company is a specified assessee. That kind of a situation it can come. So you can say, can a foreign company be covered by 115 BBDA? You might say that yes, no, you will have a double mind. But it depends on the residential status. The foreign company can be resident also, foreign company can be a non-resident also. Okay. So if the foreign company is a resident, then the 115 BBDA provision could apply. However, if the foreign company is non-resident, then we will say that 115 BBDA provision is not applicable. And this given fact that we have already discussed is considering the non-resident and the foreign company, and that's the reason we have taken the view saying that 115 BBDA provision with respect to the dividend income does not apply.
The next example which I take it up is with respect to the dividend income 115 BBD, where there is a foreign subsidiary dividend. So this is 115 BBD, where there is a foreign subsidiary, there is a dividend from the foreign subsidiary. Under section 115 BBD, there is a special rates of tax, so that is to be multiplied. 115 BBD, special rates of tax, you'll have to multiply with this, okay? Where there is a long-term capital gains covered by 112A, also covered to a special rates of tax, that you'll have to multiply with the special rates of tax and you have to get it. Now friends, one very important thing with respect to 115 BBD, which I want to bring it to your notice, okay? So this 115 BBD provision, I want to bring it to your notice. We say that the foreign subsidiary, the meaning of foreign subsidy for the purpose of 115 BBD is 26%, 26% holding. So it will be regarded as a foreign subsidiary for applying the special rates of tax. That is going to be 26% test. But if there is any intercorporate dividend set off in the dividend distribution tax chapter, there the subsidiary meaning is 50%. So if it was a foreign subsidiary dividend, remember this very carefully. If it was a dividend from the foreign subsidiary, it will also be eligible for the purpose of intercorporate dividend set off subject to conditions of dividend distribution tax chapter, but only if that subsidiary was at least holding of 50%, greater than 50% holding, only then that particular subsidiary dividend will be eligible for the purpose of intercorporate dividend set off subject to that you have already paid the tax under 115 BBD. So, in this situation, here intercorporate dividend set off for the dividend distribution tax, although here you have two foreign separate subsidiaries, but only one transaction, that is this transaction where 60% you are holding, that means intercorporate dividend set off can be eligible only towards the dividend from that foreign subsidiary where the holding is more than 50%. But the special rates of tax will be applicable where holding is greater than 26%. So this is a test of 26%. Okay. So keep that in mind. The meaning of subsidiary is different for the different purposes, and that could have made some difference in that particular calculation. Now, friends, 115 BBDA provisions. 115 BBDA provision, that is your dividend. Keep that in mind. This is very another valuable important point that I'm bringing it to your notice. 115 BBDA provisions, where the dividend in excess of rupees 10 lakh is subject matter of taxation under special rates of tax. But 222E dividend is not covered by 115 BBDA. Under dividend distribution tax chapter, 222E dividend, that is a loan to the specified shareholder, logically of a private limited company, is subjected to the dividend tax. Okay. And because it is subjected to the dividend tax, it is exempt in the hands of the shareholder. That mechanism is now very well accepted. However, if this particular amount of the loan was, say, for example, a very high amount, so the doubt will come whether 115 BBDA provision will be applicable or not. So this is one example of one individual that I have already taken. Example of this particular individual computation, where he has got a loan from, he is a specified shareholder and he has got a loan from that particular private limited company. So will that particular loan be included for the purpose of 115 BBDA calculation? Answer is now. 115 BBDA provision, friends, do not apply. I repeat, 115 BBDA provision do not apply to the 222E type dividend, and that particular figure is not included, look at this, for the purpose of tax liability calculation. However, if you would have got other 222ABCD type dividends, okay, so those dividends are subjected to 115 BBDA test. So whatever was the amount which was in excess of rupees 10 lakhs, but which amount other than 222E, okay, that will be subjected to 115 BBDA special rates of taxes. So supposing if there was an individual, he would have got a normal income, say for example 12 lakhs in this particular example, and the 7 lakh rupee was the dividend, in excess of rupees 10 lakh of section 115 BBDA, the taxable figure. So 115 BBDA taxable figure 7 lakhs, so that I will multiply with the special rates, and the other income I will multiply with the normal rates of tax. So for that I will give basic exemption slab 1, slab 2, slab 3, etc. I will apply and multiply with the tax rates of tax, add it up with the applicable surcharge and the applicable cess, and get the amount of the tax liability. What is the message here? That 115 BBDA provisions do not apply. I repeat, 115 BBDA provisions do not apply to 222E type of dividends. Okay. The next example is, friends, again with respect to some individual, say for example Miss Radha, okay, now she has again got a 222E dividend, so it is a repeated type example. So 222E dividend is not under the scanner of 115 BBDA provisions. So 115 BBDA not subjected to any taxation if it was a dividend referred to under section 222E. Okay. However, if she would have got other income which is unexplained expenditure, that is 68, 69, etc. provisions. So 68, 69 provisions, if there was any income addition, 115 BBE provision applicable, there is a special rates of tax 60%. There is a special rates of tax of 60%. So that you will have to multiply with this amount of income. Now look at this particular example. She has not been given with any basic exemption limit. Why have we not given any basic? Although she is an individual. No, she is an individual. She has got now only 5 lakh rupees income. 5 lakh rupees income is subjected to 60% tax rate. Okay. So you will feel that, oh, give her the basic exemption limit. Now, this is a special rates income. The special rates income generally is not eligible for the purpose of basic exemption limit. So although she is individual, the special rate income is not supposed to be given any basic exemption limit, and accordingly the tax liability has been calculated. Friend, another very important thing is, where there is any tax liability because of 115 BBE, that is 68, 69, etc. kind of addition, there is a special surcharge. I repeat, there is a special surcharge incorporated by the Finance Act, the unique surcharge, and that particular surcharge is 25% of that particular tax. So ultimately some people say that the tax rate by itself can be 75%. So some people say, like, you know, it is 60% plus it is 25% of 60%. So it is 25% of 60%. So that tops up to 15%. So somebody will say, some textbooks will say it is a tax rate of 75%. Some people say mathematically it may be right, but in examination condition never say like that. The tax rate is provided by the section is 60%, and the Finance Act provides for the surcharge. So always give the breakup in your examination condition. This is a special surcharge applicable if there was any tax liability which was caused or which was applicable because of section 115 BBE provisions, which is subjected to section 68, 69, etc. provisions. So the last message, is 115 BBE income, that is 68, 69, etc. income, subjected to 60% of the tax rate plus a special surcharge by the Finance Act, 25%. And anyway, because it was a special rate income, it is not going to qualify for any basic exemption. That means it will not come in that slab system of an individual. It is a flat rate of taxation, something like that. Don't write in the exam, friends, the flat rate of taxation. Now, friends, let me start with the discussion if there is a non-resident Indian. Friends, when it comes to the special rates of taxes, I guess that you people know it very well, that there are two most valuable chapters called as Chapter 12 and Chapter 12A. Chapter 12A is, friends, non-resident Indian. I repeat, it is a chapter dedicated for non-resident Indian. Now, this particular chapter, before I go ahead with a quick revision, I will just take little bit, some 4 or 5 minutes extra I may take it for a better explanation. Reason being that, friends, whenever the question has come on Chapter 12A, students have found it always very difficult. This is out of my experience, I'm just telling you. And at the second point in time, examination conditions, still, friends, this particular chapter is not fully explored. In other words, I have a feeling, friends, that once this particular chapter will come to the limelight, although it is already in the limelight, I'm not saying that it is not in the limelight, when this chapter will come in the limelight in your paper 7, then these questions on this particular chapter will have repeated questions. I mean, every alternative attempt, there can be a good question, there can be good question, there can be quality of question, can be keep on improving. So this particular chapter, first of all, it's very important. Students have normally found it very difficult for the purpose of application. Now, friends, why this particular chapter is difficult from the examination point of view and the student's point of view? The reason being that this particular chapter, first of all, is an optional chapter. This is one thing which makes this particular chapter is most beautiful. That non-resident Indian, that means a person of Indian origin who is now a non-resident, this particular chapter is a optional chapter. Optional chapter in the sense that if you think that I don't want to apply this particular chapter, don't apply this particular chapter. There is an option given to him. Okay. And the second part is, this particular chapter can also apply even after a SESI has become resident. Even after the SESI has become resident, this particular chapter can apply. In other words, when you were an NRI, that time you might have made certain investments, and now you have become resident, but still you want the special rates of tax. Okay, the law says that because you are our brother, because non-resident Indian is basically our brother and will be eligible for the purpose of this particular benefit. The general thing remains the same. Like, for example, don't get basic exemption, no expenditure, no Chapter 6 deduction, Provisio 1, Provisio 2 normally not available, but in this particular chapter, friends, the Provisio 1 to Section 48, that is your exchange rate fluctuation benefit, is applicable. So as I told you that there are some on-off kind of provision. So this is one very unique feature from the capital gains transaction point of view, that Provisio 1 to Section 40, that is exchange rate fluctuation benefit, that particular benefit is available in this particular situation. Now, in order to make an example, in order to just proceed with this particular one basic example, let me assume some numbers to begin with for the purpose of discussion. Okay. First of all, friends, I am assuming that my long-term capital gains, which is a specified long-term capital gains in this particular chapter, and I advise you, friends, you pause your video at this particular stage. Little bit time, spend little bit of extra time on the meaning of what is a specified income, specified asset, foreign exchange asset, specified long-term capital gains, which I've already explained it to you in my normal class. Pause this particular video at this point in time, turn those few pages, and thereafter you continue with this particular video. So this is your long-term capital gains, but which long-term capital gains? The specified long-term capital gains, which is part of chapter 12A. Okay. Say for example, it is 1,40,000. Okay. So that is your full value of consideration minus the cost. Okay. But say for example, if you consider long-term capital gains as per exchange rate fluctuation, that means if you convert your full value of consideration in foreign currency, cost into foreign currency, and then you compute the capital gains, is say for example, this is assumed figure, this is capital gains after the application of provision one. Okay. So if you assume, if I assume that my normal long-term capital gains without a provision one is 1,40,000, and naturally because over a period our rupee has depreciated and the dollar has appreciated, this is going to reduce the capital gains if you consider the exchange rate fluctuation benefit, and that logical number, but it can be other way around also. So long-term capital gains after applying provision one, I assume that for the purpose of discussion here, it is 1,35,000 rupees. Okay. However, the provision after applying the indexation also, I can assume that particular number. Supposing, let me assume that particular number is 1,20,000. Say for example, provision 2 means indexation benefit. So supposing if I index this particular cost, and if I consider index cost, I assume that 1,20,000 rupees. But let me tell you that for the shares transaction of the non-resident, the provision 2 is not applicable. In my regular class, I have already shown you and taught you many times, friends, that where there is a shares debenture transaction of a non-resident, I repeat that where there is a shares debenture transaction of a non-resident, to that particular situation, provision 1, I repeat, the provision 1 to section 48 is applicable, that is exchange rate fluctuation benefit can be applicable, and in any case, provision 2, that means indexation benefit, is not to be given. So, the shares debenture transaction, take it as a thumb rule, friends. I repeat, shares debenture transaction, take it as a thumb rule. If the assess is a non-resident, and non-resident Indian is a non-resident, and therefore, indexation benefit will never ever come into picture. So, keep one simple thumb rule in mind, that such shares debenture transaction will not be covered, subjected to indexation. However, subject to conditions provision 1 to section 48, that means exchange rate fluctuation can be applicable. Okay, so this permutation of the computation of capital gains is possible. Okay, now under this particular chapter covered by chapter 12A, this particular long-term capital gains is subjected to provision 1. So I have taken 1,35,000 rupees, that is this particular number, that is my assumed number, that means capital gains computed as per the provision 1 exchange rate fluctuation benefit, and accordingly I have got my capital gains number at 1,35,000 rupees, which is subjected to the special rates of tax, and I have multiplied by the tax liability. If there is any investment income, I repeat, if there is any investment income, as I already told you that you should have paused the video at this point in time, you should also know that what is the investment income, the specified income, basically it is like an interest income, basically the investment income is like an interest income, and in that particular situation you have a special rates of tax and you multiply that, but because it is covered by chapter 12A, you do not get any expenditure as the deduction. So if you make an observation here, see the income gross figure is 50,000 rupees, expenditure is 10,000 rupees, but I have not considered 10,000 rupees as allowable expenditure. Why have I not considered that? Reason being that you are covered by this particular chapter, so the expenditure deduction is not permissible, it is not allowed to the assessee. So it is gross amount of the income multiplied with the special rates of tax. So you have investment income as one specified income, LTCG as a second specified income, so this is special rates of tax. If you have any other incomes, the other incomes will be covered by special rates of, sorry, will be covered by the general rates of tax. That means assess is individual, non-resident Indian is an individual. So that particular person will get basic exemption limit towards this particular income. So this income I have assumed is how much? 1,20,000 is my other income, which is less than the basic exemption limit, that has gone for basic exemption limit. So there is no tax calculated on that particular figure. Add with the applicable surcharge, applicable sales, and get the amount of the tax liability. This is the method in which chapter 12A tax liability will be calculated. Now friends, there will be a great fun. There will be a great fun if a question comes in the exam like you calculate optimum amount of the tax liability. That means you you have to consider that if this chapter is not applicable. So what you do is, supposing if this particular chapter is not applicable, listen very carefully now. That means you are not applying chapter 12A. So now you have to calculate the tax liability by ignoring the provisions of chapter 12A, and you have to get that particular amount is going to be a great thing. Okay, so that particular point you have to consider. Now, in the normal provisions, what is going to happen? Listen to this very carefully. This income, which you call it as a investment income, for which we multiply the special rates of tax, we may say that no, I don't want to apply the special rates of tax, I want the basic exemption limit. So this particular figure may be included in your other income types because you don't want special rates of tax, you want basic exemption limit. So that could be the one dramatic change. But when you include it in the other income, that means when you say that you don't want to apply the chapter, so you will include it as a income will be taxable, but it will be taxable not at special rate but at general rates. This is what I'm just trying to tell you. Okay, but now when you do this, you have to consider the net income, because under the normal provisions, friends, you cannot add the gross income. In the normal provision, you have to consider gross income minus the expenditure. So it will be 50 minus 10. So that is going to be 40,000. So your normal income, which will be subjected to normal rates, is going to be 1,20,000 plus 40,000, and that is going to be the one dramatic difference in terms of the calculation of the tax liability figure. So investment income will go for the basic exemption, or maybe it will go in the slab rate system because of the normal provisions being applicable. But the long-term capital gains, I repeat darling, the long-term capital gains will not go, because long-term capital gains is again a special rate income. Even in the normal provision, the non-residents cannot take, I repeat, the non-resident cannot take the basic exemption limit with respect to the normal capital gains. Sometime back also already explained that to you. So your capital gains will be subjected to the special rates of tax even in the normal provisions. Even in the normal provisions, and therefore you will multiply these capital gains with the special rates of taxes. But now the doubts will come, whether you should take 1,40,000 as your capital gains, that means as per the normal, that means without considering provision 1, provision 2, or you should consider provision 1. That means your capital gains here in the normal provision should be taken as 1,35,000 rupees, or it should be taken as 1,40,000 rupees. Indexation issue doesn't come only in any situation. So this decision you have to take, whether provision 1 in normal provision is applicable or not applicable, and this is going to create a rocking situation. And at the same point in time, friends, there are many variations. As I already told you, that this chapter can be really great in the examination condition, and they can really give you sleepless nights. I'm telling you, if a detailed question comes, then these questions are going to give you very sleepless nights. And I don't know whether you are already my student for paper 6C, the international taxation. There we got to focus much more on this non-resident Indians computation, because again, lot of variety is concerned. But still, I will not give it a chance even for the purpose of paper 7. Now imagine the normal provisions. Now in the normal provisions, friends, you have a long-term capital gains on shares. Now listen very carefully. Now in the normal provisions, friends, you have a variety of variations, and the variety of the situation with respect to the computation of the tax liability with respect to the long-term capital gains of this particular shares. Okay, first of all, whether the shares are listed or the shares are unlisted. Whether the shares are listed or whether the shares are not listed. Now, if the shares are listed, then another variation comes. Whether it is covered by 112A, that means whether the transaction is covered by the recognized stock exchange, or it was off-market transaction. That means if it is off-market transaction, it is a long-term. Don't forget that here the heading, all the discussion is with respect to the long-term. That means if it is listed shares, and if the transaction is already carried out through the recognized stock exchange, and security transaction tax have already been complied with, that is one variation. The second variation is that it is a listed shares, but the transaction of these particular shares were carried out off market, that means security transaction tax have not been complied with. In this particular situation, what will be the tax implications? Now, if it is covered by listed, and if it is to recognize stock exchange, then section 112A applicable, and there the basic limit will be applicable, and under 1112A, provision 1, and provision 2 to section 48, both of them are not applicable. That means you cannot give any exchange rate fluctuation, or you cannot give any indexation anyway not come, but that particular provision is categoric. It says that provision 1 and provision 2, both of them are not applicable. So there will be one basic limit of section 112, that is 1 lakh rupees, which is fraud. That means capital gains above rupees 1 lakh will only be taxable, and at the same point in time, you have not to give exchange rate fluctuation benefit. So your capital gains figure here will be taken as 1,40,000 if it was listed and covered by recognized recognized stock exchange. However, you will get 1 lakh rupees basic exemption and excess figure will be subjected to the special rates of tax. This is going to happen under section 112A. Just look at this particular computation that I have already made it for you in this particular situation. 1 second, let me just check. It's the tiny handwritings. 1 second. So, this is long-term capital gains. It is a listed shares covered by 112A. Okay, so listed shares and covered by 112A. So I've given 1 lakh rupees basic limit, that is of 112A, and excess amount subjected to the special rates of tax. So this is how my tax liability is calculated with respect to the long-term capital gains of the listed shares covered by recognized stock exchange. And my other incomes, that investment income I've already included in my other income, which I already explained to you, which goes for basically the basic exemption limit. So practically in this particular example, there is no tax liability for the other incomes, now including with the investment income. And I add the element of the sales and get the amount of the tax liability. This is one variation. Okay, now the second variation here is in this particular situation that it is unlisted shares. Okay, that means, sorry, it is a listed share. Let me complete this. It is a listed shares, but the transaction is done off market. And when the transaction is done off market, then 112A, the special rates do not apply. 112 applies. Now under 112A, it is said that without the proviso 2, that means without the indexation benefit, okay, you can consider at a special rates of tax of 10%. But what is the difference here? That under 112A, you have a basic limit, but 112, you do not have a basic limit. That is a normal long-term capital gains kind of a situation under section 112. So in the normal provisions, supposing if the shares were listed, but if it was an off-market transaction, then anyway, these non-residents do not get that particular indexation benefit in that particular situation. But provision 2 is not applicable. So provision 1 extended fluctuation can be applicable because provision 2 benefit is denied under section 112 for the special rates of tax, but the exchange rate fluctuation can be available in that particular situation. Look at this. My capital gains number is 1,35,000 rupees because that provision 1 benefit I have already given. That is my exchange rate fluctuation benefit I have already given, and that I have straight away multiplied with the flat rate of tax that is provided under section 112 because without indexation there is a special rate. So this is a special rate of 10%, which I have already multiplied in this particular situation. And my other incomes is anyway the other incomes, which includes my investment income. So on that, it goes for the basic exemption limit, add it with the element of the cess, applicable surcharge and the cess, and get the amount of the tax liability. So this is how my tax liability has differed in terms of calculation if the shares was listed shares, but the transaction was carried out off market transaction, that means not covered by security transaction tax. Okay, so this was listed shares kind of a permutation. Okay, now in the normal provisions, you have another variation that what if the shares were not listed. Now friends, I already told you that this chapter can always create a very good variation in the examination condition. So what you have to do, you have to do a tax liability one. So for example, as per the chapter 12, you already got a tax liability number one. Then you will have a tax liability number two in the normal provision. Now in the normal provision, you have a variety of variation. In exam, you have not to apply all the variation. Depending on the situation. I mean, you don't have to solve all the situation. I am explaining because I'm in the classroom and I want to explain all the variations of this particular transaction. But in examination condition, we do not do that. So examination condition, the facts will be given like it was listed and it was on market transaction or off market transaction. So accordingly, you have to follow that particular branch of discussion. Okay. But you have to calculate tax liability two times. Now, supposing if you assume that this was listed, listen very carefully, and it was covered by 112A. So sometime back only we have done this particular calculation. So this was your tax liability figure. How much it comes? It is roughly about some 4,000. I mean, I can't see, it's a very small tiny handwritings, and I'm in a very quick mode of doing this particular. So roughly about 4,000 I'm getting, and here it is about 24,000 rupees. So what I will say, I will take the decision in the examination condition that look, it is better not to follow this particular chapter because this chapter is increasing my tax liability somehow or the other. So I will prefer, because anyway the chapter is optional. So I as an assessor will prefer not to apply chapter 12A, instead go for the normal provision. That conclusion you have to develop, and that is the reason we have to do normal provision calculation tax liability separately and the special provisions tax liability separately. Now the second set of the permutations, what if the shares are not listed? Okay, now if the shares are not listed, then there is a special permutation. What if the shares are of the private limited or others. Others logically can be public limited. Sometimes I write private and public. But it is like, what if it is a private limited and what if it is a others situation? This is, don't forget, all the discussion we are doing for the non-resident. However, in this particular chapter, NRI. So all non-resident Indians are of course non-resident. So in that context only we are doing discussion, and the title is long-term capital gains. Now before I go ahead, I want to bring to your notice one very unique piece of the legislation. Particularly, although it is exam day revision class, but still I want to just bring it to your notice because this I think is very valuable, very corner point, and many people have missed out on this particular point. Section 112. Section 112 refers to a special rates of taxes. It is a general purpose provision with respect to the long-term capital gains. However, if it is a non-resident or foreign company, listen very carefully, non-resident or a foreign company, these two type of assesses, there is one very unique special rates of tax which is provided by the law. Now listen very carefully. It is a share or securities which is unlisted. Okay, so it is unlisted securities or shares of a company not being a company in which public are substantially interested. Not being a company in which public are substantially interested logically means it's a private limited company. Assess is a non-resident or a foreign company. It is unlisted shares or securities, okay, at the rate of 10%. This is a very special rate of tax, that is 10%, which is provided without giving the effect to the first and the second proviso to section 48. That means without giving exchange rate fluctuation benefit or considering indexation, logically doesn't come, but everywhere the law prints that without considering proviso 1 and proviso 2, there is a special rate of 10% which is provided for the assessor being non-resident or a foreign company, transaction of the unlisted securities or the shares of a company in which public are not substantially interested, means a private limited company. Okay, so because of this particular provision, one extra variation has been created. So here, if it is a private limited company, okay, you have not to give proviso 1 or proviso 2. That means extended fluctuation, and that also you have not to give. Okay, so ignore these two part of the capital gains chapter. And there is a special rate of tax which is at the rate of 10%, which has already been provided. So in my computation of the capital gains, I had assumed that without proviso and the capital gains, I had assumed figure was 140,000. So my 140,000 will be multiplied with the 10% because I have not to consider any proviso 1 kind of a benefit. However, if it is not a private limited company, listen very carefully, if it is not a private limited company, that means other company, so that special rate under section 112 do not apply. So what will happen? I will consider proviso 1, that means extended fluctuation I will give. So my capital gains will be work out at 135,000 rupees. Okay, because that was the assumed number which already started with for the purpose of discussion, and this will be multiplied with a normal long-term capital gains rate of tax, and that is 20%. So you multiply with that normal long-term capital gains tax rate of 20%, and accordingly the tax liability will get calculated, and investment income will anyway be included in the other income for the purpose of, because now I'm doing calculation as per the normal provisions of that particular chapter. Now how will this particular working look like? Okay, now this particular working will look like something like this. See, 140,000 if it was long-term capital gains and if it was a private limited company. So that particular special rates of tax would have been applicable. These I have multiplied with the special rates, and I already got the tax liability, added with the element of the applicable surcharge, applicable sales, and got the amount of the tax liability. But supposing if that was not applicable, my normal long-term capital gains tax will be tax rate, that is 20% will be applicable, and in that situation I will get proviso 1 advantage, that is exchange rate fluctuation benefit, and this 135,000 I will multiply with my normal long-term capital gains tax rate, and I get a tax liability, consider the applicable surcharge and cess, and get the amount of the tax liability. So this is how the tax liability variation will take place. So ultimately in the normal provisions, friends, for non-resident you have four variations. Listen very carefully. Ultimately you have four variations. One, listed but covered by 112A, that is your on-market transaction. Listed but off-market transaction, that means 112. Not listed if it is a private limited, and others, I will just write logically public limited. So you have four different variations in the normal provisions with respect to the tax liability calculations. However, friends, I once again repeat that in the examination condition, you have not to think always all the four. No, like that. But any one variation will come in the examination condition. So you will have to calculate tax liability as per chapter 12A, and any one variety of this particular option, whatever be printed in that particular question, and that will create a beauty part of your answer. I repeat, that will create the beauty part of that particular answer. And questions here under chapter 12A generally starts only from 6-7 marks and onwards. Easy 10 mark questions can be set on this particular front. Do not ignore this particular part of the discussion. And now This is one simple, small little tip which I already referred to. This is already given it in the regular class also. Some of the clear differences between resident and non-resident type of the SSE. But let me tell you, friends, this is not exhaustive. There are many, many on-off situations with respect to resident and non-residents. But few of the most popular ones from the examination point of view, my duty is to bring it to your notice. And it is not possible for me to give you exhaustive list of the difference here, because there are many, many sections where such differences are there, that for resident, same provision, but some concession given, for non-resident not given, or vice versa kind of situation. Now, first thing is 112, 112 and 112A. These three sections are the best part, oftenly used in the examination condition. Resident person do get a basic exemption limit, but non-resident person do not get the basic exemption limit. Under other special rates of taxes, even the resident don't get basic exemption, even non-resident don't get the basic exemption limit. Here, senior citizens, 87A and 80D. These three are the most popular on-off situation. 87A rebate is not applicable to non-resident, but to the resident it is applicable on merit, subjected to that in income criteria and all that. 80D resident get a higher limit, but non-resident senior citizen do not get that particular higher limit. A senior citizen here get a higher basic exemption limit. The resident senior citizen, non-resident senior citizen do not get that particular higher exemption limit. These kind of differences you should keep it in your back memory, and wherever possible when you have done the regular study, you should have done this particular thing very, very carefully. Now friends, in case if somebody is listening to this particular video, but you are not my student and you are maybe learning this particular video from YouTube or something like that, first of all, let me tell you that I wish you all the best also. And one more thing which I want to tell you, all these illustrations that I've already given it to you, you should study them from the material or your coaching class or your teacher, whosoever has taught you this particular subject. And in case if you don't have that exact ones, you can take down this particular illustration in your notebook as a illustrative examples. That will also work out wonders for you, let me tell you. So for example, this particular example which I have taken as a matter of variation, you can also take it down in your answer book and practice them as an illustration, because that detailed question answer etc. are not possible for me to share it with you on the online media. So please try to do this best and get the best out of whatever that you can get from me as far as possible. Okay. Now friends, let me start with the discussion of the DTAA, Double Taxation Avoidance Agreement. Friends, this is a very important chapter from the international taxation point of view, and roughly about 6 marks on an average type questions do keep coming out from this particular chapter. Now friends, now because it's a very quick examination day revision, I'm not going to details of how the double taxation is created or coming into existence and it gets eliminated. The basic thing I already explained to you. But logically, I will just speak a few words on that. See, for example, if a property in the foreign country, the foreign government will tax that particular money. Why? Because the income accrued in that country, because the property is located in that particular country. But Indian government may also tax you, may because you are resident in India. So Indian government will tax that money because you have residential status. Foreign government will tax that particular money because it is accrued in that particular country, and accordingly this kind of double taxation gets created. The double taxation will have to get eliminated. The elimination of the double taxation can happen depending on the situation. Okay, so one of the situation is that India and that particular country, so India in that country with which you had a transaction, as at the government level has signed up agreement called the double taxation avoidance agreement, or there is no double taxation avoidance agreement which has been signed up. If there is no double taxation avoidance agreement, then there is a special rebate which is to be given. We call this a rebate under section 91 with respect to this particular DTAA, where it do not exist between India and that particular country, but elimination do takes place. If there is a DTAA, then you have to follow what the DTAA says. That means DTAA makes the provisions that double taxation get eliminated in this particular manner, how the tax credits can be given, etc., etc., kind of situation, and accordingly. The main reason and main how the double taxation gets eliminated is something like that. In either of the situation, the general thing which I'm just telling you, the general thing is that you have a tax liability in a country, say for example India, and whatever tax you have paid in that country, so tax in that country will get as a credit, and the net figure will be your tax liability. But it doesn't happen so simple that the tax paid in that country. It has to be worked out in a specific manner. It has to be worked out as per the specific provisions which is provided under the provisions of the law, or it is provided under DTAA provisions. So there has to be a method. You may not get full 2 lakh rupees. Supposing you said that 2 lakh rupees you have paid, but you may not even get full 2 lakh rupees credit. You may get something less also. So in other words, you have to do the working. Basically what I am trying to say, that the main focus here is on the tax liability calculation. I repeat, the main focus here is on the tax liability calculations. That means first you calculate the normal tax liability, including your doubly taxed income, and from that some rebates, some relief, some adjustments are to be carried out. Ultimately, friends, it is something like your tax liability reliefs, which has been provided by the law. Let me take up the hardcore basic example in the given situation. There is one assessee, say for example, he has got a foreign income. This is the simplest example that I am already taking, and this is your foreign income. And India and that particular country do not have a double taxation avoidance agreement. So normally if you refer to the questions will categorically print that India and that particular country has a double taxation agreement or do not have a double taxation agreement. So it depends on the situation. I repeat, it depends on the situation that whether you have double taxation avoidance agreement or not. But the given example, the given question that we are trying to solve is keeping in mind that India and that country does not have that particular thing. So this foreign income is included in your computation. Do all other computation normally, all deductions etc. you give and get the amount of the tax liability. Sorry, get the amount of the total income first. Okay, but the total income already includes your foreign income. Normally this particular income in our simple international taxation language will be called as a doubly taxed income. A doubly taxed income means logically this income is also included in the tax liability for that country. On this particular income, logically you also pay taxes in that particular country, and therefore it is a doubly taxed income. So get the total income, then do your basic exemption slabs, etc., etc., etc. Now the assessee here is a resident. Okay, so normally these particular reliefs are generally available to the assessee types resident. Keep this in mind. The reason being that this is the country, the home country, where you are already facing the tune of the double taxation. Okay, so you get a total income, then you consider the basic exemption where the assessee was resident and a senior citizen. So we have given a higher basic exemption limit, and you have considered slab 1, slab 2, etc. on the merit, applicable surcharge and cess and everything on merits. You have got that particular tax liability number. Once you have got this particular tax liability number, the next important thing is to do the average. And what you want is the average rate of tax. What is the average rate of tax? Whatever is the total tax liability divided by or to the proportion of your total income, what is the percentage that you get? This is called as the average rate of tax in home country. That is average tax of average rate of tax in India. This is your step number one to understand. This average rate of tax is your Indian average rate of tax. I repeat, friends, it is called as the Indian average rate of tax. Now, this Indian average rate of tax, you multiply with the doubly taxed income, that is 1,10,000 in my example. So you will get doubly taxed income taxed in India at average rate of tax. That is one number that you want to develop. Listen to this very carefully. I repeat, the doubly taxed income taxed in India at the average rate of tax. What is the tax liability in India on the doubly taxed income is something that you want to know for the rebate purposes. So your Indian average rate of tax, doubly taxed income, when you multiply this, you get the tax. So on the doubly taxed income, which is in my example 1,10,000 rupees, how much the tax come on average basis, that particular amount is the amount of the taxes on this particular case. Okay. Now the same method you want to apply to the foreign country, that what is the foreign tax you have paid, listen very carefully, and what is the foreign average rate of tax. So this doubly taxed income in the foreign country at the foreign average rate of tax. Now practically, friends, you can do the same type of working, but with respect to the foreign country law. But that is not part of our study, that is not part of our understanding, because in that case you will not study the law of every country, and every country will have this particular what is slab this, what is slab 1, slab 2, and what is basic exemption. Every country will not have that particular concept, but ultimately law want to do that only. But from examination point of view, friends, from the examination point of view, because it is not possible to give all this data of that particular foreign country, somehow or the other, the hints will be given to you in the question that this is the income of that particular country. On this, you have paid some tax in that particular foreign country. I repeat, this will be printed in the question. You have to read in that particular question that on the doubly taxed income, how much is the average rate of tax of that country? So you want again two things. You want average rate of tax, either it may be ready-made printed in the question, or some data will be given in the question which you have to use that particular data and you have to derive that particular number, multiply with the doubly taxed income. So that depends on the question facts. Okay. So now this is again your doubly taxed income. This is the amount of the tax that you have already paid in that particular country, and you get the average rate of tax of that particular country. Now this is tax on average basis on doubly taxed income in India or in that particular country, whichever is less. Okay, whichever is less is your special rebate, which you call it as an elimination of the double taxation. You give that particular special rebate, deduct it from the tax liability, and your net tax liability will get calculated. I repeat, and your net tax liability will get calculated. By doing this adjustment, your answer comes to an AND. Your answer comes to an AND. This is one of the very, very valuable aspect, and question look like this for about 6 marks in the examination condition. The another variety of the question here is that in this particular question, the situation was something like that. There is a double taxation avoidance agreement. That means India and that particular country has already signed up a double taxation avoidance agreement. Okay. And income is not taxable in your country, but it is included for the rate purposes. I repeat. So the situation is something like that. You already have a DTAA. So situation is not this, that you don't have a DTAA. There is a DTAA. And DTAA between India and that particular country says that the income is not taxable in your India, say for example, but it is included for the rate purposes. So, but it is included for the rate purposes. Now, this particular statement, only one line statement printed in the question, can really make a dramatic change in terms of answer. And the students have normally found this particular way of reading this particular question is very, very difficult as understood. Now, let me tell you how this particular answer is to be delivered and how this particular answer is to be interpreted from the examination point of view, and it is to be understood. Remember this one thing very carefully. It is not taxable, but it is included for the rate purposes. So it means what? It means what? It means that your Indian income will only be taxable. It's your Indian income will only be taxable, but your Indian income will be multiplied with the average rate of tax. Your Indian income will only be taxable because that foreign income is not taxable in the other country. This is as per the DTAA provisions, and your Indian income will only be taxable, but your Indian income will be taxable at the average rate of tax. But for the purpose of calculating the average rate of tax, the amount of the doubly taxed income will be included for the rate purposes. Okay. So how do you attempt to this particular answer? Now listen to this. This is your foreign income. The foreign income as per DTAA income is not taxable, but it is included in India for the rate purposes. So this particular amount is a doubly taxed income, but it is included in the computation for the rate purposes. So it is included for the rate purposes. You got a gross total income, normal chapter 6A deductions you have given, and you got total income on this particular front. Once you have got the total income, don't forget total income is already included the doubly taxed income, but actually doubly taxed income is not taxable. Okay. But it is included only for the rate purposes. It is included only for the rate purposes. That means for the average rate calculation purposes, it is included. Now, this particular amount, you have to use your basic exemptions, slab 1, slab 2, etc. Your tax liability calculation, basic exemptions, slab 1, slab 2, etc. Multiply with the appropriate rates of taxes, applicable surcharge, applicable cess, and get the amount of the tax liability. This is a pure calculator work. Once you have got this particular tax liability, you have got an average rate of tax. So, what is our average rate of tax, friends? I once again and again repeat, although it is an exam day revision, but students do mistakes here. So, your tax liability and your total income. This is the average. You have to use this particular percentage as an average rate of tax. That means, what is the total tax liability and how much is the total income? Make it and convert it into an average percentage. Okay. So, here that average percentage is some 13% and the odd number. Now comes the real crux of the answer. See, you have a tax liability in the given situation. So, you have not to give rebates here because law doesn't say that you have to give the rebate because it is anyway not taxable. But you have calculated the average rate. So, what will happen is your Indian income will be multiplied with the average rate of tax. So what you do is that from your total income of that 10 lakhs and some odd number, you have to exclude the foreign income. That means a doubly taxed income. So that comes to some 8 lakhs and some odd number. Okay. So that is exclude. This is basically only your Indian income. Now you have to focus only on Indian income. So Indian income will be multiplied with the average rate. And this is your tax liability in this particular answer. So your net tax liability is calculated as Indian income at Indian average rate of tax, and multiply that particular figure and get the tax liability. Why have we done this? Because it said that foreign income is not taxable in India, but Indian income is of course taxable in India, but at the average rate of tax, and the foreign income is included for average purposes. This is a very unique piece of double taxation avoidance agreement which was printed in the question, and accordingly the answer has been given. The next very good type of the example for DTAA, that way there are many varieties of DTAA. Friends, if you have done my regular class, I have given you so many varieties of DTAA type questions which can really rock you and really give you some fundamental things, but this is only your exam day revision. So I mean, I am not going to take you a lot of time because your time is more precious than my time at the today's point in time. So your time, I don't want to take much. I wanted to keep it very restricted and give you maximum time for your own revision, because your own revision is best, rather than sir revising it for you or something like that. You should do it, help yourself. That's the best part of it. And friends, again, I don't forget to wish you all the best. Okay. Now, this is another good part of the variety of the questions with respect to DTAA. See, in DTAA, now what you do is average rate of tax multiplied by the doubly taxed income. So you want the doubly taxed income as one part, and you want the average rate of tax of that particular country and in India also. Okay, but here the problem is that in this variety of question, you have some foreign income and you have some foreign losses also. So that's a problem, and the problem starts with that only. So you have a foreign income, but something is lost, something is income. Okay, something is lost, something is income. Now, friends, in India, as per Indian law, the set off is allowed. In Indian law, we have already studied that the losses can be set off against the income, subject to some exceptions. That is not the part of this particular question. So losses is allowed to that particular set off. Okay, so we have already done the set off. But the question has printed, listen very carefully, the question has printed that in that country, that means in that particular foreign country, the losses of that country are not allowed to be set off. Now that creates a big problem. I repeat, now the question will print that the losses of that particular country, which is actually this number, some 6 lakhs and some minus 6 lakhs and some odd number, that particular figure is not allowed for a set off in that country, but Indian government is giving it to you. Now that creates a very good variation. Friends, I have seen so many types of questions where sometimes they will say that it is exempt in that country but taxable in this country, or maybe it is exempt in India but it is taxable in that country. So that kind of permutation combinations they will keep on creating, and then they will ask you that you have to calculate the double taxation relief. Okay, so that creates a problem. Now listen very carefully, in this kind of situation, the basic method of calculation remain the same only, that you calculate their normal, now total income, then the tax liability, and get the average. So average rate of tax, the calculation up to that particular stage, it is almost the same. But then the doubly taxed income, the rebate calculation is going to be very fancy. So two things you want to know, listen very carefully. One is, how much is a doubly taxed income? Listen very carefully. What is a doubly taxed income? A doubly taxed income is the income which is taxed in India, and it is also taxed in that particular country. Now if I give you a very simple example, supposing there is a situation where there is some income but it is exempt in that country but it is taxable in India, for example. So supposing if you say that you have a foreign country, you have India, okay, forget about this example for the time being. Now foreign country says that it is exempt, India says that it is taxable, or it can be vice versa. That means ultimately what happens is that only one country is taxing it. I repeat, friends, only one country is taxing it. And if only one country is taxing it, there is no double taxation. I repeat, ladies and gentlemen, that if only one country is taxing it, that means both the countries are not taxing as per the laws of their respective countries, it does not amount to double taxation. And since it does not amount to the double taxation, there is no question of any fancy adjustment, any double taxation relief only don't come into picture, because friends, there is no double taxation. In other words, for it being a double taxation, both the countries should have been taxing it. That is one of the key area of this particular discussion. Now if you see here, now friends, in this particular situation that you got to keep it in your back memory is, what is a double taxed income? Now say in this particular situation, you have India, you have foreign country, okay? Now in India, you have already got, let me check, this is a standard and handwritings, but let me check. It was some 44 lakhs and odd number. 4480, and there is a loss of 640. Just check some number, because it's a very tiny numbers. I am not able to read that particular properly in my very quick revision class. Okay, so in India you are getting that particular set off. Now in that particular country, friends, in that particular country, this particular set off is not allowed. So in India, what is taxed is a net figure of 38 lakhs and some 40,000. Okay, because in India, Indian government is already giving you the set off of that particular losses. Now foreign country, you are not getting it. Okay, so in the foreign country, that particular set off is not allowed in that particular country. Okay. So in that particular country, your income tax is how much? Only 4480. You don't get any particular set off. Now the point here is that what is the doubly taxed income? That means what is the amount of the income which is taxed in India also and in that particular country also? I repeat, what is the amount of the income that is a doubly taxed income that is taxed in India also and in that particular country also? And that figure is 38,40,000. So the doubly taxed income, I repeat, the doubly taxed income is only which is taxed in India also and in that particular country also. So doubly taxed income is 38,40,000. The basic method of calculation remains the same, but the amount of the doubly taxed income is 38,40,000 in the given example. In other words, 6,40,000 is not taxed in India, but taxed in that particular country. So that is not a doubly taxed income. So that will not come in eligibility criteria of the relief on account of the double taxation. That is number one point. Okay. Now proceed with this particular situation. What will be the average rate of tax for India and for that particular country? So now you start with this particular question, your normal gross total income, your normal deductions and your total income, calculate basic exemptions, slab 1, slab 2, etc. Get the tax liability, applicable surcharge and the cess, and get the amount of the tax liability. Okay. Now, once you have got this particular amount of the tax liability, you will get the normal average. So this is your average, your tax liability and the total income. This is your average. Okay. And this particular average is your Indian average rate of tax. So doubly taxed income multiplied with the Indian average rate of tax and get the amount of the tax liability. So it is like a doubly taxed income as per Indian average rate. What is the tax liability? That is number one situation. Now friends, what will be the average rate of tax of that country? Now in that particular country, you had 44 lakhs and 60,000 as the number. Sorry, 80,000, I guess. One second. Let me check. Okay. It was 4480. So that particular number 4480. Now set off in that particular country is not allowed. So logically of that particular country, your income taxable will be this particular number. On this, how much the tax comes, and this is going to give you the average. This is going to give you the average of that particular country. Now, if you see that particular question data, in that particular question, it was given to you that this 4480,000 was some $70,000 because it was your foreign income, so it was into the foreign currency. That was $70,000 of 44,80,000 representing $70,000. That means setup was not allowed. And on that, some 10,000 and odd number was the dollars on account of payment of taxes in that particular country. That data has to be printed in the question paper, and that was already printed in the question. So you calculate the average rate of tax based on the income taxed in that country and the tax paid in that country. Same method, but the exact working we can't do because we don't know the country, that country law. So you have to use that particular question data, same mechanism, that country has not given the set off. So ignore that particular point. On that, how much the tax liability paid in that country, get the average of that particular country. So it gives you an average of 15% in the given example. That you multiply with the doubly taxed income and get the tax liability. That is your doubly taxed income as per the foreign average rate of tax. I repeat, that is your doubly taxed income as per the foreign average rate of tax. This or this, whichever is less, is the amount of the rebate, and that rebate you have to adjust it from the tax liability and get the net tax liability. So this was one very good variation of the question where there was a loss involved into that foreign country, and the loss was not allowed to be set off by that country, but Indian government allows the loss set off, and that particular adjustment in double taxation and the average rate is already considered. And this is one very good variety of the question with respect to the double taxation avoidance agreements.